Did you know that Nnamdi Azikiwe also felt as hopeless as the youths of today in his own time? Surprised? Let's listen to a portion of his autobiography, where he narrates a desperate attempt to flee to America on a hazardous journey that almost cost his life. Zeke was then just 17 years old. Let the youths of Nigeria listen and learn. This audiobook is a legacy project culled from the book titled My Odyssey, an autobiography written by Nnamdi Azikiwe.
This audiobook is a narrative from My Odyssey, an autobiography written by Nnamdi Azikiwe. Chapter 4, In Quest of the Golden Fleece. A father's sacrifice to enable his son to prove his mettle. Poetry. I shall pass through this world but once. If therefore there be any kindness I can show, or any good thing I can do, let me do it now. Let me not defer it or neglect it, for I shall not pass this way again. Stephen Graylett. 1. Adventurers of the Atlantic. We had dreamt dreams, we had seen visions, we had planned how to make our dreams come true. Now we were confronted with the problem of doing what we had been thinking about and planning. Alas, while six of us had dreamed and planned the adventure, only three of us were ready to take the plunge when the testing time came. The seamen had assured us that when we had paid the prescribed fee, they would arrange our sailing. We had saved sufficient money and we were prepared to pay the seamen. The spirit was willing in all of us, but in half of us the flesh was weak. Mr. Adibua had been employed by the agriculture department and he had been transferred to the more plantations at Ibadan. Mrs. Johnson and Jackson could not make up their minds to leave the civil service so abruptly. I was prepared to throw away my job and damn the consequences. Sidney Brown was prepared to do so as well, and John and Yasu joined us in this irrevocable step. At the time, Sidney was a technician in the Post and Telegraphs Department, and John a printer. Sidney wanted to improve his knowledge of telegraphy and telephony and become a telecommunications engineer, and John's aspiration was to become a professional and qualified printer. When it became obvious that our three friends were no longer energetic as they had been 2 years earlier, I suggested to Sidney and John that the three of us should swear an oath of loyalty to the common cause. Having done so, we decided on a particular date to leave Lagos bound for Liverpool on board the RMS Apam. Having made the necessary arrangements with three of the crew, it was agreed that for the payment of £15, we would be stowed away to Liverpool and be the guests of our seamen benefactors until we were able to secure employment in boats plying to American ports. We had enough funds due to the novel Esusu method practiced by us the previous year. The whole arrangement was made in secrecy, and since we were not little children, we realized the risk that we were taking. Sidney and I, especially, who were civil servants, understood what it meant to leave our jobs without notice, contrary to the general orders. But we were social rebels, and we had dreamt of self-realization After passing through the rigors of hardship and of our academic life in America, we had solemnly reckoned the losses before considering the gains, and had decided to strike while we were young and daring and adventurous. On the appointed night at 11 o'clock, near the general post office, we joined a canoe which taxied us from the Elder Dempster Quay alongside the Appam. Our friends were on hand to receive and advise us. We were to mingle with the passengers and sleep in one of the lifeboats until we had left Freetown. When it was anticipated that we should be accommodated in the bunks of the sailors and be given some odd jobs to do with the firemen down below, we agreed, and the next day we sailed from Lagos, resigning our future to the hands of Providence. Not one of our relatives or closest friends knew when we left. Not even any of our three former comrades had any inkling of it. We were afraid of being found out and having our carefully laid plans shattered. Our first night on board, we were seasick and were unable to eat the special food our friends on board had served us. Sydney was especially sick. He started moaning at midnight when we were at sea. This was most embarrassing because we had hidden ourselves in one of the lifeboats. But when Sydney's condition became worse, John was upset and told me point blank that no person on earth would thwart his ambition to reach America. He swore that he would stop at nothing if anybody tried to play hanky-panky with him. I myself was downcast, but I suggested that we should be patient and hope for the best. It was possible that after a day or two, Sydney might improve. Then we could continue our voyage without fear. The next morning we reached Accra. The sight of the town was pretty. Having mingled with the deck passengers, we were not detected. Sydney implored that we should go ashore to enable him to regain his health. Then we would resume our voyage, but John and I refused. Sydney wept in vain, telling us that he felt he was going to die. That afternoon, we sailed from Accra, bound for Sekondi. Sydney's condition had worsened. He was incoherent in his speech, vomited a great deal, and wept like a baby. Seeing him in such a plight, I began to shed tears of pity for the unfortunate adventurer. John was also in tears, and the three of us were in a quandary. Then John called me aside and suggested in low tones that since Sydney seemed destined to be a fly in the ointment of our ambition, we should dump him at sea in the dead of the night, so as to continue our voyage without hindrance. Besides, this would be an act of mercy, for the poor fellow might die anyway. I convinced him of its inhumanity, and we agreed to bear with Sydney, to suffer together in silence, and to pray to God for better luck. The next port of call was Sekondi. On arrival there, Sydney insisted that we should disembark and that if we did not, he would spill the beans. After a secret conference, we decided to disembark to enable Sydney to recuperate. I was deputed to see our sailor friends to implore them to refund the money we had paid them, and to assure them that on the return voyage of the boat, we would be in a position to rejoin them. When I interviewed the seamen's spokesman to explain our dilemma, he frowned on me and uttered in pidgin English words to this effect. Waiting you want here, bo? You know Sabi say this place? Be where sailor man they stay? waiting you to tell me about money. Me not see you before, and me not know you. So you be stow away. You not say it be crime to stow away on board. All right, me they go report to the purser. Say some stowaway they on board. I was chagrined because the man completely denied having known me or having received any money from me. Since he was serious in his threats to hand me and my colleagues over to the purser, I thought it prudent to placate him. As a Christian, I had been taught that a soft answer turns away wrath, but grievous words stir up anger. I begged the sailor to be reasonable and not to think that money was everything in the world. I said that if he saw the condition of Sydney, he would agree with us that no other alternative was open to us. My soft answer mollified him, and his wrath subsided. He meditated for a while and said to me, "Me understand what you mean, Bo. But you see, sir, me be workman here. You know what is wrong with you Africans? Una too sentimental. Una think say the world go wait for una always to serve your pleasure. Why you not heap the poor devil overboard and go your way? Now you want to make I give you back the money where we don't share among ourselves and we don't take arm. Go give some Lagos woman at Portonovo Market Street." Having explained to me that the money had been squandered and that he was prepared to keep his part of the bargain provided we performed ours, he concluded that we, and not themselves, were at fault. But he did not hesitate to warn me that if I tried to expose the deal, he and his colleagues would land us in trouble. He advised that I and my comrades should ponder deeply over the matter and realize our delicate position. When I explained matters to John and Sydney, we decided to go ashore and forfeit our money, since health was better than wealth. Sydney realized the noble sacrifice we made and thanked us for it. Our next problem was how to land ashore. In June 1924, the construction of the Takoradi Harbour had just begun, and it was necessary that we should go ashore on surfboats manned by fancy boatmen who looked like black Apollos, their physique marvelous to behold. Our friends advised us to report to the purser that we were not able to purchase tickets before sailing from Lagos, but that we were prepared to pay for the fare from Lagos to Sekondi. The purser accepted our explanation and assessed us accordingly. We paid and we were allowed to disembark with the other passengers. Our experiences in an unknown country, whose people we knew nothing about and of whose language we were ignorant, can be imagined. Personally, I had heard of Sekondi as a place where my boyhood chum, Solomon Nnemeka Orakwe, was trained, and at Onitsha there was a colony of fancy men and women, some of who were from Sekondi. Our first stopping place there was the market. Here we regaled ourselves by eating pancakes made with corn and bananas. They were delicious. By now, Sydney felt better and was able to eat a bit. John was very morose about the whole affair, and judging from the expression on his face, he was a disappointed man. He was sulky and irritable. He was the eldest of us three adventurers. While we were having our refreshment, somebody passed by and heard us chatting in Igbo. Behold, he was a cook named David Okeleke. "What are you folks doing here?" inquired the gentleman in Igbo language. He was short and robust, his face beamed with smiles. We replied in Igbo that we were bound for Liverpool, but one of us became seriously ill, so it was necessary for us to disembark at Sekondi. He asked where we came from. We replied that Sydney and I came from Onitsha, and John from Okigwe. He told us that he came from Umuoji, a village near Onitsha, and he was the cook to the general manager of the Gold Coast Railways. He invited us to his home, where we enjoyed his hospitality, and through his cooperation, we settled down to fend for ourselves. After staying at Secondly for a few days, we decided to seek employment. We went to Takoradi, but we were disappointed since we found the atmosphere very hostile to us because we were Nigerians. We could not obtain employment at the Mark Alpine Works, not even as laborers. I was actually engaged by a European as a laborer, but I was not permitted to work due to the intervention of the African foreman, who indicated that since I was not a native of the place, I did not understand the language and would not perform my duties efficiently. Meanwhile, Sydney had fallen in love with a well-to-do woman who owned a local hotel. So he was economically secure. John was employed as a compositor in the Methodist mission. I was unemployed and disappointed. I felt that if with my education, I was not good enough to be employed as a laborer in the Takoradi Harbour Works, then my education was a failure. I thought it tragic that of the three adventurers, I was the only one with secondary education, yet I was the only one of the three who was still unemployed after 2 weeks stay in Secondi. I applied to several firms and government departments for employment. In nearly all of them, I was discouraged by the Africans in charge simply because I was a Nigerian. I was told by other applicants that such discrimination was rampant, not only against Nigerians, but also against other Gold Coast tribes. During my stay in Accra, 10 years later, I appreciated the correctness of this statement, for I noticed that the Ga discriminated against the Fanti, the Twi, the Ewes, the Ashanti, etc., and vice versa. At last, I was offered an appointment as assistant bookkeeper by the West African Literage Company Limited at £60 per annum. I accepted and found my European boss very considerate, but my African colleagues were peeved and would not cooperate with me. I persisted patiently and optimistically, and after a few days, the European remarked that I was bright and had an aptitude for figures, so he gave me a more responsible job. After a week in the office, I received a letter from the Commissioner of Police, Western Province, in reply to the application I had made for employment in the police force, that I had been selected for training at Accra, and that I should report to him immediately if I desired the job. I went to my European boss and told him that I wanted to be relieved of my job in order to join the police force. He granted my request and paid me off.